Hi. Thank you so much for coming to this last reading of Western Carolina's annual Spring Literary Festival. I have a few things to say about the festival before we get started. My name is Laura Wright. I'm a professor in the English department. The Spring Literary Festival received support from the North Carolina Arts Council, a division of the North Carolina Department of Cultural Resources, and is funded in part by a grant from the South Arts in partnership with the National Endowment for the Arts. This project is also made possible by funding from the North Carolina Humanities Council, a statewide nonprofit and affiliate, the National Endowment for the Humanities. Finally, the festival relies on support from the 2021 WCU campus theme, Water, the Office of the Provost, the College of Arts and Sciences, and the English Department. And I just wanna say, during this reading, if you have questions that you want to ask, you can share those, post them on social media throughout the reading, and we will address those at the end. So it is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to one of my favorite authors of all time, Edwidge Danticat. And I'll start by saying that Danticat's first novel, Breath, Eyes, Memory, was published in 1994 and became an Oprah's Book Club selection 4 years later, which is pretty amazing for a first novel. She has since written numerous other works, novels, children's books, a biography of her mother, short story collections, and numerous works of journalism that have appeared in such places as The New Yorker. And she's received more awards than we have time to list, including a National Book Award, a MacArthur Genius Grant, and honorary degrees from Smith College, Yale, and the University of the West Indies. Danticat was born in Haiti, and she began writing at the amazingly early age of 9. She immigrated to the United States when she was 12, leaving a life lived under the brutal dictatorships of Papa Doc Duvalier and later his son, Jean-Claude. Among other things, her work engages with transnational and transcultural issues of identity, the immigrant experience, genocide, the recovery of lost memories, and the impacts of historical trauma. I regularly teach her 1998 novel, The Farming of Bones, which tells the story of the so-called Parsley Massacre of 1937, during which Trujillo, then dictator of the Dominican Republic, ordered the slaughter of approximately 20,000 Haitians living and working in the Dominican Republic. Several years ago, the English department wanted to come up with a marketing campaign, and one of the things that we were gonna do was put famous quotes by authors on various items, cups and bookmarks and all kinds of things. And the department had asked us all for a quote that we wanted to share. And the one that I chose was a quote from Danticat's work, Create Dangerously. And the quote is, "Create dangerously for people who read dangerously." That is what I've always thought it meant to be a writer. Writing, knowing in part that no matter how trivial your words may seem, someday, somewhere, someone may risk his or her life to read them. So it is my pleasure to turn this over to Edwidge Danticat.
Hello, good evening. Thank you, Laura, for that wonderful introduction. And thank you to the Spring Literary Festival and to all of you for being here. I'm very excited to participate in this conversation later also with Sarah and Whitney and those of you who send your questions in. I thought I would start by reading some nonfiction. I have been writing mostly nonfiction this past year because like most of you, I have been at home. So I've been at home being a mom, being a writer. It's like all my jobs have been in one place. And fiction, which I love writing, especially short stories, but fiction has seemed a little bit like really distant to me, even though I've sort of, I dip in and out of a book that I've been writing for a long time, but I've mostly been writing essays and reflecting. And this is one, this is a bit from an excerpt from one that I guess is my most recent one. And I chose to read it tonight because actually on the panel with me are, you're all writers. And I know a lot of you who are writing are writers. And it's called Writing in Place. My 15-year-old daughter, Mira, is taking a pre-college summer writing class online. I wish I could take this class, I tell Mira. What I mean is, I wish I could have taken this class when I was 15. I have read most of the assigned essays. We read When We Dead Awaken, Writing as Revision by the poet Adrienne Rich. I have been looking for something more concrete than my own enthusiasm to convince Mira that this class is an incredible gift, especially in the midst of a global pandemic and anti-racist protest, at a time when we are all, writers and non-writers alike, searching for the right words to describe our new reality. Then I come across Rich's saying, the essay was originally a talk, writing is renaming. The other piece Amir and I read together is Audre Lorde's Poetry is Not a Luxury. Lorde reminds us once again that, quote, there are no new pains. We have felt them all already. In an August 30th, 1979 interview between the two women, Lorde cites her choral poem about the frequent silence around the lives and deaths of murdered Black women and girls, a poem called Need, a Chorale for Black Women's Voices. In the poem she writes, how much of this truth can I bear to see and still live unblinded? How much of this pain can I use? When I ask Mira what she's writing for the essay class, she demurs, then she tells me that her first piece is about a tree she and her friends used to sit under in elementary school. The same tree where a boy hit you in the forehead with a rock, I ask. I'm not going to write about that, she says. Why would I think that she would want to write about the worst thing that has ever happened to her under that tree? Because that's what I would do. She will be writing about digging for worms under that tree with her girlfriends, she says. Girlfriends who now go to different schools and have different friends. Like most of her writing, I will not be allowed to read it. This has been our rule since even before elementary school. It's like having a doctor in the house and saying you won't let them see your wounds, I say. Exactly, she says. Once, while driving Mira to that same school, we were listening to an audio version of Tilly Olson's I Stand Here Ironing, a short story about a mother discussing her troubled teenage daughter on the phone. I can never revisit that story without thinking of my own mother and the many Sunday nights she spent ironing in her bedrooms, first in our crowded two-bedroom apartment in East Flatbush, and later in the house my parents bought in that same part of Brooklyn. When Tilly Olson's character speaks of having to send her daughter away, first to family members, then to a girls' group home, and of the daughter's ensuing separation anxiety, I always feel a lump in my throat. In the car with Mira that day was the first time I was hearing that story as a mother and in the presence of one of my daughters. At the end of the story, I looked back at Mira in the back seat, and tears were streaming down her face. Overeager and excited, I asked her what exactly about the story was making her cry. Which part moved you, I said, which action, which image, which phrases? Was it the daughter not being able to keep her mother's letters or any personal possession with her in the group home? Or was it that final line in the story where the mother wants her daughter to know that the daughter is, quote, more than this dress on the ironing board, helpless before the iron, end quote. After I pushed a bit too much, Mira answered, I think I cried because you are crying. Midway through the essay class, while going through a box of old knickknacks, I find a wooden machete my mother gave me a few years before she died, a memento she'd bought during a stop in the Caribbean while on a cruise. Running my fingers across the wood's roughly carved reddish-brown veined surface, I wish my mother was still alive so I could ask her why she had picked that particular keepsake for me. After the essay class ends, I tell Mira that I'm going to write about my mother's wooden machete. I tell her that finding this machete at this particular time, I can't help but think that my mother is sending me a message somehow. I imagine that my mother is telling me from behind the veil of death to stay strong and to even become more of a warrior. I remind Mira of a time when she was 6 years old and we took my mother to the airport so she could return to her home in Brooklyn after a long visit with us in Miami. We waited for Mama, as I called her, Mira called her Gun, to clear security and wave goodbye to us before making her way to her gate. As an adult, taking my mother to the airport and watching her leave was one of the most recurrently painful moments involving her and me. Each time we had to experience this particular ritual, I wanted to scream because these moments reminded me of my first concrete childhood memory, which was of being peeled off my mother's body on the day she left Haiti for the United States when I was 4 years old. Mysteriously, or perhaps not so mysteriously, that day as Mira and I watched my mother merge into the crowd heading towards her gate at the airport in Miami, Mira suddenly screamed, "Mama!" at the top of her voice, as if to call my mother back to us. My mother turned around and stared at us. She seemed relieved that there was nothing wrong with either Mira or me. As other travelers were dashing around her, my mother took a few steps in our direction, then stopped. She seemed to want to walk back to us, but knew she could not. Coming back to us now would mean just postponing another goodbye. Her life at that time was in New York, as were her house, her friends, and her church. My mother's flight was already boarding. She slowly raised the hand that had been resting on her carry-on bag and waved once more. Then she turned around and continued walking to her gate. Before the plane took off, my mother called to ask if Mira was okay. Until that moment, I half believed that I had been the one who'd cried out for her. "Mira is fine," I told her. It was as though she'd wanted to tell Mama, she'd wanted Mama to know that we were there. It also felt to me as though the part of me that was in Mira had gone back in time to that airport in Port-au-Prince to help me scream for my mother. Around that same time, I happened to be reading Roland Barthes' A Lover's Discourse. In A Lover's Discourse, Barthes writes, "Absence persists, I must endure it. Language is born of absence. The child has made himself a doll out of spool, throws it away and picks it up again, mining the mother's departure in return." Hearing Mira call for my mother in the airport that day made me wonder whether some absences also persist into the next generation, absences that are as much my inheritance as hers. I asked Mira if she remembers what happened at the airport that day. She remembers us taking my mother to the airport a bunch of times, she says, but does not remember ever crying out for her. She does recall another moment at the same airport though. Once, while my family and I were waiting to board a flight to New York with my mother, Mama went to look for a restroom near our gate, then accidentally walked past security, leaving the boarding area without her boarding pass or her cell phone. When our plane began boarding, Mira and I went looking for her and found her pleading in her hesitant English with an impatient TSA officer to let her back in or to at least accompany her to the gate and to us. She looked so lost and so scared, Mira remembers, like she thought she would never see us again. I had also feared that day that we might never see my mother again, or that she might end up on the wrong flight to some distant country, or as an eternal ghost in the airport, passing everyone by. The words my mother would later use to recount to her friends the experience of being lost in the airport now trickle back into my mind. M'pedzi, yo joenmwe, voyage la continue. I am lost, they find me, the journey continues. Sometimes she would add, get chance m'pege héritage. I was lucky to have had heirs. My mother often used the word héritage, heritage, to describe us, her children and grandchildren. Heirs, heritage, a lineage, she believed, could be useful, helpful, and perhaps can even feel your pain across generations. Thank you.
Wow. Thanks for sharing that with us. That's new work, you said early on, right? Mm-hmm. That you're, yeah. I wondered if, before we play a game and get silly for a second, I wondered if you could maybe articulate why nonfiction, and maybe why inhabiting memories, maybe why the pandemic you feel like has sparked some of that, if you can identify that.
I think it's, you know, I think the pandemic has taken away so many of our rituals, and both my parents spent most of their lives in New York, you know, their post-Haiti life in New York, and they had so many friends. We lost so many friends of theirs there, and I have had within that period of this year and a half or so to watch some of those funerals, you know, online. And so I've really have been thinking about them a lot and what this would mean for us at this period of time. And, you know, I know I haven't seen my brothers who are in New York in so long, and I don't know that I would have, like, what we would have done if my parents were this age. Would we have to somehow get them here or go to them? And so I started thinking a lot more about this kind of absence, you know, these separations, because part of my story is like, it's like a lot of young immigrants, you know, lives is about separation. And and then I was also starting to think about the future and really begin cherishing so much more those moments where my daughters and my mother got to be together. And I wanted really to encapsulate them and put them somewhere to just have them, those things written down. So it's part, you know, it's part of a continual, you know, continuing exploration of that for me, of like a separation and coming together and coming apart again. But this year is sort of had to think, you know, I just was thinking about it more. And also I think I had sort of more time at home to think about it and to write about it too.
Yeah, I was thinking too about the kind of weirdness of time during the last year, you know, how it sort of moves in a different way. And there's that folding in and over of generations in what you read of, you know, your daughter screaming and, you know, your mother lost and you lost. It just kind of collapses in on itself in a way that was really compelling, I think. And I guess that's the one thing I want to say before we get into the game is that, you know, Laura talked about teaching your work over and over and over. And I came to your work as a student in college, and it's sort of an unexpected trajectory now that I look back on it. You know, I'm a white, straight guy from rural Appalachia, and I read Crick Crack in college, and it kind of blew me away. And I had no connection to the lives of Haitian women. I knew hardly anything about Haiti, but something about what was happening in that book was one of those moments where literature sort of cracked open a little bit more for me, you know, and I was like, oh, you can do this with language. Like, you can do this with voice. And so I was thinking about that when you were reading that piece now, that I haven't lived those experiences, but there are these universal inroads in what you read. And it's really, I don't know, it works in a really kind of big way, even though it's a really singular story.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I mean, I think too, that is the, you know, that is the power of literature, that it can reach out and sometimes, you know, you come across the thing you need in the moment, right? Like in the way that the work speaks to you. and the value of it is that we're thinking, you know, we all experience, you know, we're all human beings, we experience certain things. And then I've had that which I consider so valuable, that shock of recognition, no matter where the writer is from, where it's like, oh, that's exactly how that is. That's exactly how I feel in that moment. And I think also that's the power, that's the sort of the power of, that goes beyond the page and reaches out to us as readers, because, you know, as writers, we're also, most of us are readers first.
Yeah. Well, what I would like to do, in a little bit, we're going to have some questions from some students and then pull in some questions from the audience. But what I'd like to do is play a little game. The advice that I always hear writers give other writers is never go to Goodreads. And if you don't know Goodreads, this is the place where readers can leave reviews and rate books. And it seems like healthy advice. But I went to Goodreads for you so that you didn't have to go. And I've pulled out some good, but a little odd reviews of some of your books, and then I've mixed in some fake ones. And so what I want to do is play Two Truths and a Lie, Goodreads edition. So I'm going to read three of them, and one of them is made up. And I think I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how this goes. So I've just pulled from a few different books. So here are three reviews from, and these are just lines from the reviews from of Inside Out. Okay, number one, I liked how they were all shirt stories. Number two, wow, I didn't even know how to read and I love this. Number three, I'm not ashamed to admit I'm afraid to death.
Oh my gosh. the fake one, I would say, I don't even know how to read.
Good, yes, you got it.
Oh. Okay.
Ding, ding, ding. All right. So you earned 53 points. Okay.
All right. That seemed a bit of an oxymoron. I was like, okay. All right. But the shirt one almost made it, but I've done that typo myself.
So. Yeah. Sure. The shirt one was good. Okay. Okay. Here are another three. Number one, phew, y'all. Was it me or is Danticat really out here trying to twist our hearts? Number two, poverty, earthquakes, HIV, corrupt governments. Number three, I didn't know I wanted to be punched this hard.
I would say I didn't know I wanted to be punched this hard.
You're on a roll, yes. Oh. Two for two. Okay, let's move on to the do breaker. So here are three reviews from that one, maybe. I want to steal her sentences, maybe I will. Number two, this is a terrific book, don't at me. Number three, you finish reading a book, you drop it, you lie down and slowly assess how you feel inside because you know you are not okay.
I would say the one with don't at me, because I guess you can't at people on Goodreads.
I don't know if you can or not. And it seems like such a weird thing to say don't at me about, because he's saying it's terrific, but that one is actually true.
Oh,
that was a real review. The fake one was, I want to steal her sentences, maybe I will.
Oh, okay.
All right, here's another set from that same book.
The sentences remain unstolen, so good.
You can keep them for now.
Yes.
But I've given someone an idea, so who knows. Mm-hmm. Okay, number one, simple, heartbreaking, yes. Number two, my good Goodreads friend Janet gave me this book and I just found it in my stacks. Oops, sorry, I have taken so long in reading it. Number three, I haven't read it, but I really love the cover.
My good friend Janet.
No. Janet is real. Could you believe that one?
Oh, okay.
It's all lowercase letters too, which makes it a little better.
Wow, okay, it's the cover then.
So the person who hasn't read it. Yeah, the cover, you got it. Okay. I've got a few from Crick Crack. Let's do a set there. Number one, the most beautiful and moving stories I've ever read, they are about Haiti. Number two, I don't know who was talking, but I loved her. Number three, six-word review, a phantom limb and a sea children.
I would say I don't know who was talking,
Yes.
That's
right.
Okay. See, yeah, this
the Phantom Limb and Sea Children are real.
Yeah, I think that is sort of odd enough that I thought it would be real. But you know that with the cover, with that book, I remember doing a reading one time and a very beautiful woman came and she said, I only got this so I could go get my hair done and ask them to do my braids this way. And then she said, while I was getting my braids done, I read it and I liked it. So, and
that's the power of the cover.
Yeah.
They are very tight braids.
Yeah, and it took a very long time. Yeah. So she read the whole book while getting the braids done. So that was a good thing.
Wow. Okay, how about this one? Number one, I just bought a ticket to Haiti. Number two, these stories have no mercy. Number three, found myself on the subway a few times, trying not to let a tear escape my eye.
People have bought tickets to Haiti, so I've been told that too. I bought a ticket to Haiti, that one.
Yeah, I made it up, but it sounds like it's true. So
yeah, people have told me that, and or they've already had their ticket, but they're taking that book among others with them.
Yeah, that's amazing. Okay, last one. You're killing it so far. I almost never give 5 stars, but this woman can write. Number two, this book is but a girl how has a dream being a writer. Number three, would read it again, but my pig ate it.
All right, I'll go with the pig one because I don't know that many readers with pet pigs, but there might be.
Who would surely you've got some. You've got a lot of good readers, I can tell you that.
But I don't think my good readers would let their pigs eat my books. But you never know. Let's Everything's possible. Yeah,
let's hope that. Okay, well, thanks for indulging us. There are lots of good reviews on there, though, but you should still probably stay away.
No, I should stay away because, you know, like all writers you've ever met, you'll just remember the bad ones.
It's true. Yeah. It's true with course evaluations too. Speaking of, I have two students, a former student and a current student, Sarah Rue and Whitney Waters, who have some questions for you. Whitney currently teaches in the English department. Sarah is a month away from graduating from our MA program. Welcome.
Hi, I'll start us off and thank you again for being here. We really appreciate your time. So my first question is, how does your identity as a Haitian American influence your work? And do you find that you typically write with a Haitian audience in mind?
Well, I think, you know, being Haitian American is a big part of my work because it's a big part of who I am. You know, it's how I was born and moved in the world, my story, my attachment to Haiti, my migration here and my life there, my life here. So a lot of that is in my work. What's the second part? Sorry. The second part of your question?
Do you find that you typically write with a Haitian audience in mind?
Oh, okay. So I typically try not to write necessarily with any audience in mind, because for me, if I were writing with a Haitian audience in mind, I would be thinking of the people closest to me first. Like I would be thinking, you know, before of my parents, of my aunties, of my, and that would be intimidating because there are very tough critics. So I try to write really when I'm writing, I think of the girl I was when I was 15 years old, who was recently arrived from Haiti. And I had already read a lot of the books that they had, like the Haitian books, the books in French that they had at the library, and was just looking for everything I could manage to read. So I feel like I write for that girl. And, you know, there's a very famous Toni Morrison quote, like, if there's a book you want to read and it hasn't been written yet, you should write it. And I think in part that was part of my starting to write. But I try to narrow my audience, if you will, to that girl. And I write for her. And now sometimes when I'm writing, I think of my daughters, I think of my nieces and nephews. And I feel like they would be more forgiving than my elders in terms of what I write. And I think, oh, it would be great if one day they read this, you know, after I was gone. So I think that's also kind of an audience. But I try not to really aim at any audience because it is intimidating. And I trust so much, and I say it a lot, of this Haitian proverb that is, parole gen pied, parole gen zèle, words have wings, words have feet. And I think, you know, the words travel on their own and sometimes find really surprising audiences in the same way that, you know, Toni Morrison once, you know, said that Tolstoy didn't know he was writing for a little black girl in Lorain, Ohio. And the same way that I didn't know she was writing for me, and maybe somebody will read me, like, you know, Jeremy said, who didn't know I was writing for them. So that's why I would like to just kind of let the words travel on their own without sort of aiming in any kind of way.
Thank you again, especially for reading that beautiful essay earlier.
Thank you.
I have a question about audience as well. But Laura mentioned that you've written children's books, and I think you've also written some young adult novels. And so I'm wondering what that experience has been like writing for those audiences of different ages and how you've maybe approached them differently than you would adult audiences.
Yeah, those writing my picture books, I started actually doing picture books after my daughters were born. And those have been so much fun to do. And I think at some point they will come and ask me for their you know, piece of the pie in a way, like they'll want royalties, because a lot of the ideas for the picture books kind of emerged when I was reading them. I read to them a lot, you know, picture books, and then more like mature books as we went along. But that's really what made me want to write picture books. And I write in all these different genres because I don't like to get bored. So, I mean, for me, and also because of that, like, you know, if you have young kids, you can't, like, I can't go off often to just kind of work on a project for 6 months. So I kind of, I'm hopping around anyway. And sometimes you have just a pocket of time and you can do something shorter. And then you can incorporate the life you have into the work. And so that's really been in term, you know, for that, you know, the younger books. And the approach, to me, it's not too different an approach. You're always told writing for younger people not to condescend because it's younger people. So I try to think of it as a different kind of first person. So you wouldn't write about a character, you wouldn't write a first person character who's 90 the same way you would write one that who's like 8, like in many of the stories. So I just think of it as a different way of writing a first person or a writing a character that's fitted to their age. So I have one of the first middle grade books I've done, Behind the Mountains, is going to be reissued this summer. And I had to reread it to write a new introduction. We're going to have a new cover. And it was really exciting. It's like 20 some years old now. And I have to say, I was kind of like, oh, I'm glad that it was, you know, sometimes you like, you want to rip your hair out the way you write something, like, oh, that's not so bad. Because of that approach of thinking, you know, this is a character, but she's, you know, 16 instead of like the older characters that I write. So I approach it from the point of view of a 16-year-old as opposed to, you know, just kind of trying to sound like every 15-year-old, but like this specific character in this specific situation with this specific voice.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
You've already spoken a little bit towards this, but I was wondering if you can elaborate on your experience as someone who immigrated to the U.S. as a young person and how those experiences inform your writing.
I think a little bit, you get the beginning, a bit of the beginning in that essay in terms of how I came to the U.S. But I came to the U.S. in 1981. This is now my second pandemic, I guess, in America, because the first one was the AIDS epidemic. The year I arrived, people started, Haitians were the only people identified by nationality as being of high risk for AIDS. And that had a lot of consequences in terms of the people my parents knew who lost their jobs because people didn't know how, the disease was transmitted. And there was a stigma with, we couldn't donate blood for many, many years. And there's a big march in 1990 on the Brooklyn Bridge about that. So arriving at that time, and just immediately realizing, there was no time to even like process kind of like there was no honeymoon. There was this like you get here and all of this and you'd go to school and the kids would beat you over this one particular issue among others. And so that to me really sent me into books. It's just sent me into a lot of reading, into a lot of digging, a lot of like researching what it means to be Haitian and sort of even as a way of countering what was happening around me. So eventually the very first thing I wrote as a young person for a high school newspaper in New York City was about my first day in the US and sort of what I was expecting versus what actually happened. And I would try to write about sort of like how we spend Christmas and just kind of, it was as if, like this 15, 16 year old girl that I was saying to people, hey, we're just like you, and I didn't, I wasn't doing like consciously, but there was something I wanted to share about who we were to immediately, to override what was being said around us or to have another kind of story there. So I it affected a lot. And coming of age too, in terms of like then realizing I knew I wanted to share stories. I knew I wanted to write. I didn't know whether I was going to write a book or whether I was going to write other things, but I knew that no matter what else I was doing, I would write. And so I think that also was something I kept a lot of diaries. So I was always approaching writing with the idea of incorporating like my own life experiences in there. So I think coming at that age certainly affected that, and it definitely had something to do with the language I write, the fact that I write in English, because at that time, it's sort of like coming to English and coming to writing at this particular time and feeling for me a lot of also writing in English was a way of like protect, like not letting my, sort of like hiding what I was writing from my parents because I thought it would be too painful for them. And so it really, I think that the age and colliding sort of like reading and writing and these experiences certainly affected how I started writing and also like Breath Eyes memory and how I've continued to write.
So my next question is about kind of writing about those personal experiences in memoir essays. I'm curious how you fill in gaps of, details you might not remember, or if you're writing about something that's not necessarily, entirely your experience, how you kind of obtain the knowledge that you need to flesh it out. For example, we read an excerpt from your memoir, Brother, I'm Dying. It was the part about your uncle being detained by immigration. And it seemed like you had filled in some of those gaps with research, with actually looking at the documents surrounding that event. And so I'm wondering, about that and about maybe other strategies you use to fill in those gaps.
Yeah, I do a lot of research. So for example, with Brother, I'm Dying, we had to, like, I had to get those records from the government, and there was an organization, American for Immigrant Justice, that helped me, that filed a lawsuit. So I had to get the records. And then there were government reports, like human rights organizations that filed reports about what happened in Haiti at that time. So they were very detailed reports that I used to fill in some, you know, to have a timeline and get some details around what was happening overall in the neighborhood. And so I had, when I was writing about my uncle's time in detention and in the hospital, I had a full carton like of medical records. And the government is very good at note taking. You know, they had everything from, like, we gave him chips at 9:45. I mean, it was hard to get those notes from them, but they had a very detailed. So I used that, and then of course I interviewed my relatives who are in Haiti, my aunt who had tried to get my uncle out of the neighborhood. I talked to my cousin. I you know, what I spoke to with my uncle, who also was a good note taker, and we were given his briefcase. So I did a lot of research, because I also was, when I was writing that Brother I'm Dying, I was trying to recreate that for myself, because one of the most painful element of that experience was that I didn't get to say goodbye to my uncle. I didn't get to see him at the end. None of us did. And so I was trying to recreate for myself also what it was like for him. And like in the piece I read, you know, in the memoir too, I realized when I talked to my brothers about certain moments, especially when we were younger, they remember them completely differently. So I tried to incorporate that, like the same with Mira, like I, you know, to say, you know, make sure that her, I would never want her to read that and go, oh, you lie, you know, you lied. And so I know she, you know, I asked her, and I, you know, the fact that she doesn't remember, I feel like it's part of the storytelling to say, like, other people remember this differently than I do. So, but it's very tricky in memoir, because other people will always most likely remember it differently than you do. And so you have to find, you know, a way to, you know, to tell that, and also, if necessary, to incorporate other viewpoints. But I find that there are things now that are very easy to check. You know, if it's something that's out in the, if you're trying to say, I went to this baseball game with someone, and then, you know, now, you might be able to check online when the game happened, and then you realize you misremembered. So I do a lot of fact checking too, because I think that helps with kind of solid, you know, making the narrative a bit more solid, even though you have your own objectivity, you have your own way of remembering it.
So sort of in a similar vein, much of your fiction is historical fiction, or portrays historical events. How do you go about blending factual research with fiction and developing these fictional characters such as Amabel and the Farming of Bones?
All right. I love research, and I'm probably not the first writer you've heard this from who are like, the danger of research is that you can be trapped in research forever, because one thing leads you to the next thing, and it's just as fascinating, and you're, you know, so I did a lot of research on the massacre, and I, you know, I did site visits, I did interviews with survivors, and when I was writing that story, I wanted to find a way in. For me, that was the biggest quest of just like finding, you know, if you're telling a story like in the Farming of Bones, in which thousands of people were killed. So how do you, like, for me, the biggest thing was a way in. And I remember reading, I was reading a short book called Blood in the Streets by an American reporter who had gone down to cover the massacre after the fact. In the book, he told the story of this young woman that he had heard of, a young woman who was serving dinner to someone in Toyo's army, and a Haitian woman who worked in their home. And at the end of the dinner, you know, the order came, and at the end of the dinner, this man who this woman had worked in their home for a long time, he killed her as to show his loyalty. And I thought, that's my in, this is my character, but she will live, right? She will survive and she will escape. And so, and that's really all the research at that point sort of then I could enter and I could start writing. And then I did research as I went along. I did more research to, you know, as I went along. But once I had this way in, that was, you know, the way where the research and the creativity merge. And sometimes that, you know, that comes early, but that took me a while to actually find an entry point into the story to kind of find that crossroad, you know, where the research and the fiction, you know, merge, and then you're on your way.
Can I ask, are short stories different? Is the sort of entry point usually somehow different for you?
Yeah, with short stories, it's sometimes the entry point is like a line or a dream, or could be like a vision. So for Everything Inside, for that story collection, there's one story at the beginning called Dosas. And I remember that came when I was walking in my, you know, I was walking through my neighborhood and someone had a sign in their window that says, nothing inside is worth dying for. And I thought, oh my goodness, what does that even mean? And then what it meant was like, it was like a threatening thing to people who might break into this home. And I thought, oh, it should be, you know, I was like debating with myself. It should be everything inside is worth dying for. and then that's how that came about. And so, and with Claire of the Sea Light, I remember watching a documentary and about orphaned children in Haiti who are not really orphans. They're, you know, the family, and I had a friend like that, her, you know, parents couldn't take care of her and they put her in an orphanage and they would visit her in this orphanage. And I was watching this documentary and someone, one of the missionaries said, you know, they don't, it's not the same. They don't feel the same about their kids. And I was so mad. And then Claire of the Sea Light, this character just kind of popped up in my mind. So when it's a short story, I feel like I'm able to jump in faster because I, you know, I can like, and sometimes it's a fault, you know, it's actually a good feeling. You could jump in quicker. But with a story like With That Inspection, which is at the end of Everything Inside, that story took me, I knew I was going to write a story about a man falling from a building, but it took a very long time to see like, well, what else would be after that? So sometimes you have an image. With the short stories, I'm less afraid to like leap in. I can leap in and even if I start writing, I stop, but it's a little less scary than a much longer project.
We have some questions from social media, so I don't want to take up too much of the time, but I'm so struck by how, like in the two examples you've given us right now, how it's a kind of horrible thing that you just undo a little bit by adjusting the narrative to make it fictional, right? And so I'm wondering about the kinds of questions that lead you into your work and when you decide that the question that you want to pursue needs to be pursued in fiction. And sometimes you might think like, you know, this really bad, this social issue or this thing I actually want to write about straight on in nonfiction. Is it a conscious choice or do you just sort of find yourself going into, you know, the fictional world or into your own life?
The choice, the fiction, nonfiction choice for me is, it's usually the urgency. It's like, because the fiction takes a lot longer to frame characters around. So if there's something I feel like, oh, this is the, you want to say it more directly, you want to say it now, you want to just lend your voice to the moment, I think that's the urgency. It's usually what decides whether it's fiction or nonfiction for me. Even though, you know, a memoir, you know, writing about my uncle's death and immigration custody, that was a longer scale project because I really wanted also to tell his whole life. He had wanted to write a memoir when he was alive, and he never got to, and my father died at the same time. But and even with that, I had never written a book so quickly in my life, because I felt like, you know, I had to put it down. So I think that's, for me, that's the choice between fiction and nonfiction, and that there's often an urgency to the nonfiction. And then the fiction, you really have to live with it for a while, the idea for a while. And then characters have to emerge that feel like real people. And then you have to put them through some things that they have to resolve. Whereas the nonfiction, the what you want to express already exists, but you're trying to find a way to say something about it, or to approach it, or shape an already existing experience.
Yeah, I heard someone, or read on social media, someone saying that writing a novel was like putting together a puzzle, and writing an essay was like playing Jenga, where you're like pulling things out and just seeing if it'll hold together. I don't know if that feels true for you or not, but here's a question that's kind of related that someone posted on social media. And they wanted to know how you, if you're working on pieces in different genres simultaneously, how you juggle that. If you're writing, you know, an essay and working on a novel and thinking about a children's book, like how you're managing all that at once.
Well, I'm realizing, you know, as I get older, I can't do many of it at once. I usually, if I'm working on a longer, like if I'm trying to work on a novel, sometimes I do like the breaks of having to write a nonfiction piece, of having, you know, to have a change of pace. But I can't do too many. I can maybe do two at the same time, a longer scale thing and then some shorter pieces. But I can't do three or four things. I knew one person once who, a writer who had like three desks, and she was like, this is my nonfiction desk, this is my fiction desk. And maybe that's a good way of dealing with it, of compartmentalizing it. But for me, it's just harder. Like unless they're very like strikingly different, they would really merge in some way. But I can maybe do at most, like while I'm working on a longer project, then take a break to write an essay. Like if I'm working on a novel, I can write essays. But if I'm working on a novel, I can't really do short fiction because I feel like all my fiction energy would have to go into the novel. So it's, but it's, you know, for whoever's writing that, I often think when people ask the question, it's like you have to just do the, like work the way that works best for you, right? And we all have to honor that, like no matter what other writers do, but it's, you know, just do what works for you, because that's ultimately what's going to get you, you know, that it's going to get you what you desire. Like just work around the life you have and do what works for you.
Well, someone still wants some piece of knowledge that they can take away and apply to their own life. And this is probably a question you get a lot, but how often do you experience writer's block? And if you do, what do you do with it? How do you get past it?
I don't so much get writer's block, only because I have probably, because of all the other things happening in my life with my kids and, you know, my other obligations. So there are times when the writing feels like a stolen moment. And so, and I would say just have, you know, in the moments where you're not blocked, just have a bunch of things that like you list that you would love to do if you had the time, right? And non-blocked, like just have potential projects always lined up. And they can be varied, they can be, but if that doesn't work, free writing. For me, that's, I usually get, not so much writer's blocks, but I will get stuck in the middle of things. I will start something with great enthusiasm, and then I will be stuck. And so at that time, I try to do like that Julia Cameron exercise where you wake up in the morning, the artist way, where you wake up in the morning, the first thing, you just do some free writing. And you take the pressure off. And sometimes if you're stuck, you might have an idea that's not yet ripened. So read. When I'm stuck too, I do a lot of reading. I do reading and the genre that I would like to like, and like I read writers who seem like they've written the book like what the one I'm trying to write. So that helps a lot, because sometimes in the middle of reading a book, you're like, oh, you come up with a solution for your own blockage. So I would say read people in your direction, do some free writing, and sometimes also go out and live a bit of life. I mean, as much as you can safely now, to kind of refeed your, you know, just like renourish, and then come back to that project renewed, you know, with some reading in you, some free writing, some sharing. And if there's, you know, if you have other writers, you know, you can share experiences with, and community is also great if you're able to manage it in whatever possible way.
Well, we're running out of the time where we can keep you, but I need to point out that I've made a terrible mistake. We have the wrong name for your most recent collection below your name.
Oh,
and it's everything inside. So I feel like I need to correct that so that people can go and buy it. It won so many awards, a National Book Critics Circle Award, among others, in fiction. And just a, you know, like Crick Crack, I think, in a way, even though more here than there, all of these different lives kind of contained in this one collection, and a really compelling collection of stories.
Well, thank you. That will be my next one. That's the sequel, Inside Out. Which tells a lot about me, because I didn't even notice it until you said that.
Oh, good. Well, if anyone else out there did, go and find the actual book and then gear yourself up to buy the sequel, which you'll be writing next year as soon as we get off this call. So thanks everyone for joining us. Thanks to Whitney Waters and Sarah Rue and Dr. Laura Wright for taking part in tonight's event, and especially to Edwidge Danticat for giving us some of her time and for sharing her words and putting them out into the world, because they're hitting us all and hitting people on Goodreads and changing lives.
Thank you.
This is the last event of the 19th Annual Spring Literary Festival, and we're so glad that you spent some of your time with us. I want to, again, thank all of our sponsors. Thank Western Carolina University. Thanks to my intern, Cassidy Barbie. And thanks also to Pam Duncan, who carried this festival for so long and then handed it off so that we could keep it together this year. If you're a student, or if you're not a student, if you'll hang on for a second, you'll see a link to a survey or a QR code. If you could give us a little bit of information there, we would really appreciate it. But we're so glad you spent this evening with us and spent some time at our festival, and we hope to see you back here next spring. Thank you very much.